This is my famous Voron Zero, aka 24/7 Zero. Speed Banshee world record, up to 1000 millimeters per second printing, yeah, it's crazy fast and it's been a while. Now it's time to revisit and to review that beast of a 3D printer. Why did I choose those upgrades? How fast is it really at quality printing? What needs to be improved in order to go even faster at better quality? Ladies and gentlemen, fasten your seatbelts and start your stepper engines. That's gonna be an interesting ride. Come on, do it! The hereby shown 24/7 Zero Beta 1 modifications for Voron Zero can be downloaded for free at gumroad.com. It lately hit 10,000 clicks and 1,000 downloads. Thanks a lot for your interest, I have not expected that. If you appreciate my work, consider donating and rating when downloading. This helps a tiny bit to cover my expenses. A big thank you to everyone supporting 24/7 printing in which way ever. In early 2021, Stefan from CNC Kitchen showed an adorable little printer going at quite insane speeds at that time. For me, there was no doubt. I needed to build that one and ordered exactly the same formboard kit in China. After my better half successfully built it, a friend of mine asked, "Have you tried printing a speedboat according to the speedboat race rules with that?" And that was when my YouTube channel was born, because after 2 or 3 tries I uploaded an 8 minute and 48 second speedboat race print video. That video was quite successful, as it was the fastest CorexY printer in that challenge at that time, and because that hype about Voron printers was just about to take off. I loved the idea of the speedboat race and I got a bit obsessed by its idea, namely, improve your printer and your slicing in order to make it faster. And that's what I did, step by step. On my Voron 0.0, I tried to stay at default components as long as possible and I printed a second speedboat still at default hardware. 5 minutes and 10 seconds. And trust me, this was tough on a Voron 0.0 with those tiny NEMA 14 stepper motors and with the stock Dragon High Flow hotend. The idea of using compressed air in order to support the part cooling was not the greatest, but cooling is maybe the biggest challenge to overcome at speed printing, and even more for a Voron Zero. The time had finally come for upgrading the motion system, the cooling and the extrusion capabilities, in order to literally print the world's fastest 3D Banshee in October 2021. Fun fact, the actual record holder at the speedboat race also used my 24/7 Zero designs along with other upgrades. So what's the philosophy of my Voron Zero speed concept? Let's dive in. After dedicating quite some time for the speedboat race, it was clear to me. Throwing stronger stepper motors, more stepper motors, or just more voltage at that printer only couldn't really be a clever solution for quality at speed printing. You'd only move the same masses quicker, on the same belts and on the same supporting frame. That doesn't help for accuracy and therefore doesn't help for print quality. Newton tells us one very simple rule. Force is mass multiplied by acceleration. In a simplified manner, that's mostly the only formula you need to think about in this concern. Stronger motors just do one thing. More acceleration at same moved mass and therefore higher forces hitting the construction of your printer, which causes displacements and therefore quality issues on the prints. So for the motion system, I tried to cut off as much weight from the moved masses as possible. That was when I had the best and the worst idea at the same time. I printed the X-beam, the tool head and the joiners from PET carbon fiber. All in all, I shaved off around 54 grams, which was an important enabler for that fast Banshee at the speedboat race. Though it had its downsides, which we'll discuss later. And 54 grams doesn't sound much, right? Let us talk about relations. On a default Voron 0.0, which is a Bowden concept, the all-in-all weight shoved around is around 268 grams, which already is ridiculously low. For perspective, the tool head only of an X1 carbon weighs 574 grams and is considered lightweight. For a Voron Zero, which is a Bowden printer, shaving off 54 grams of the moving masses is a weight reduction of over 20%. Looking at Newton's formula, we can profit from higher acceleration at the same forces on the construction. As a result, the resonance is improved. The recommended maximum acceleration for quality printing is close to 20,000 mm per second squared for the limiting y-axis. For that crazy 3.5 minute speedboat print, I was able to go at 150,000 millimeters per second squared acceleration. You might realize a big gap between insane speed printing and fast printing at quality. Can we ever close that gap? Now that we can use higher acceleration and therefore also reach higher speeds, we also need to extrude the filament at a higher rate. ESUN's ABS Plus at temperatures at or above 280 degrees Celsius quickly became the go-to filament for the participants of the speedboat race challenge. What we still needed were ultra-high flow hot ends that were able to melt the plastic fast enough. On my Voron 0.0, I started with a Dragon high flow hot end, which is good for around 30 cubic millimeters per second continuous extrusion. Sticking to the speedboat race rules, you print at 0.25 mm layer height and you typically use the max allowed line width of 0.5 mm as it simply means less movement necessary and therefore lower print times. Theoretic continuous extrusion at 30 cubic millimeters per second means you could theoretically print at 240 mm per second. Now, because a 3D bench is not continuously extruded, as there are a lot of retracts and small moves, you can set the requested top speed quite a bit higher, but at some point you run into under extrusion. CHT was not a topic yet at that time. The Sliced Engineering Magnum Plus is capable, but heavy and way too expensive and bulky to be mounted on a Voron Zero. So longer melt zones had to do the trick. And that's why I'm happy to have met Nitram with his crazy Delta printer. He's one of the early contenders at the speedboat race and he experimented with longer melt zones in order to overcome the extrusion topic. He came up with a volcano style heater block for mosquito style heat sinks and heat breaks and organized group buys for his block. All in all, a fully equipped aluminium Volcomosk is even a bit lighter than my Dragon High Flow. It's good for around 40 cubic millimeters per second extrusion rate, which I successfully tested with printing at 1000 millimeters per second. For science, of course. I still use an E3D Hemera at Boden Config, which does its job, but there are quite some drawbacks. I'll talk about that later. Now that we leveled up motion and extrusion, what about the cooling? Cooling was a tough topic for my 24/7 Zero and it still is for most printers. The Boden toolhead of the Voron Zero is defined for tiny 3010 blower fans, which are the same for the direct drive mini afterburner of the Voron 0.1. Part cooling always was the greatest drawback of the Voron Zero, so I experimented. Bigger 4010 fans with overvolted 4010 fans and with externally frame-mounted part cooling inspired by Mira C's Havex. I was convinced very early that this was the perfect solution for a small printer like the Voron Zero. I also liked the idea of removing additional weight by getting rid of the toolhead mounted fans. I still wanted to point at least some parts of the airstream towards the nozzle, so I quickly designed and added these fancy air ducts. Four crazy 40 by 28 mm Delta Industry server fans are responsible for huge amounts of air thrown at the bill space. All in all, it's an, let's say, effective concept. Quickly designed, definitely not perfect, with powerful fans and probably more airflow than you'd ever need for regular printing. The rest of the story is history. Yes, I printed a fast but ugly 3.5 minute benchy, I did my super scientific 1000 mm per second experiments and I printed that 9 minutes 3D benchy at, let's say, near to acceptable quality. The question many of you had, and also a question no one with one of those crazy prints has really answered yet is, what about real life or let's say casual quality printing? Or in other words, how fast is this 24/7 Zero concept really? Let's compare it to a wide field of 3D printers I have tested and which you have already seen in my last videos. We have a Prusa MK3S Plus, a BIQU Hurakan with clipper firmware out of the box, the Bambu Lab X1 Carbon, the LEO Voron 2.4, the LEO Voron 0.1 and the FLSUN V400 Delta printer with clipper out of the box. Where possible, I used the default slicer settings as well as the default firmware settings. Concerning the models to be printed for the print time comparison, I had to make a complete change in comparison to my last videos because of the tiny build space of the Voron Zero. We have Blackbeard by Wexter, Minas Tirith scanned and published by Sir Ren, a Before Wednesday version of the Adams Thing by JS Studio, and of course the 3D Banshee designed by Daniel Norre at settings sticking to the Speedboat Race rules. Talking about settings, for the Voron 2.4 and the Voron 0.1, I used my speed quality optimized settings in Prusa Slicer, which worked well for dozens of print hours. For the 24/7 Zero, I did a ton of testing silently some time ago in order to find a good balance for quality at high speed printing with PLA. The input shaping maximum recommended acceleration for the essential y-axis is stated close to 20,000 mm per second square for the actual setup. Acceleration ranges from 18,000 mm per second square for parameters up to 30,000 mm per second square for non-quality affecting features like infill or travel moves. Speeds are set between 230 mm per second for outer parameters and 800 mm per second for travel moves. For the infill, I go full bore at 600 mm per second and I combine the infill for every two layers because I can. This demands a very high flow rate at that speed. Meanwhile, I upgraded to a CHT 0.4mm nozzle along with the CNC Kitchen Volcano adapter, which I tested a while ago. For PLA printing at manufacturer specified temperatures, the setup is good for 45 to 50 cubic millimeters per second on a Volcomos, and that's where I capped the max volumetric speed in Prusa Slicer. But now, let's finally have a look at the print times. The big picture, excluding the 24/7 Zero, is quite the same as on my last comparisons. With the BIQU Hurakan, you already save quite a lot of time in comparison to the Prusa Mark III. The X1 Carbon print time of Minas Tirith is quite noticeable though. I suspect the combination of low acceleration for those many top solid layers and drastic slowdowns for small features as well as overhangs as the cause. I am not 100% sure though why it takes so much longer. Please leave a comment if you have an idea. Comparing the 24/7 Zero to the Prusa Mark III, the differences are quite remarkable. For prototyping, it can make a huge difference if you have to wait minutes instead of multiple hours. At comparable quality, looking at the relative print times, we can group the printers into four categories. The last generation, represented by the Prusa Mark IIIs Plus, the lower end current gen, represented by the resonance tuned BIQU Hurakan running on Clipper, the enthusiast current gen with the Vorons, the V400 and the X1 Carbon, and we have the 24/7 Zero representing the next gen, which will most probably be, and I say this with humble confidence, more than 2 times faster than the current gen. Is that mind blowing? Yes, definitely, but there's still a lot to do. That's why I said will be, at least concerning my 24/7 Zero concept. Let's discuss! At first glance, the print quality of the 24/7 Zero is comparable. Looking closer, we still see slightly wavy patterns on the surfaces of the prints. The cantilever print bed and the frame are too wonky in order to support the accelerations and speeds for that last bit of surface quality. In addition to that, my PET carbon fiber 3D printed X-beam lacks torsional stiffness. This altogether induces tiny displacements while printing, even at these kind of reduced speeds and accelerations. The good news, there are quite easy to do fixes for these issues. You'll see in the next video. Make sure to ring the bell. You won't miss that. Concerning extrusion, at the moment I'm evaluating alternative hot ends, nozzles and extruders, because more flow is more better, right? Also, with the Hemera slipping at its limits, it gave me quite an annoying time. We need more torque and also higher speed capabilities because the necessary higher pressure advance values quickly showed the limits of that Bowden setup. You can listen to the step losses here. The cooling performance of the 24/7 ESPC is absolute overkill in various aspects. The airflow and cooling power is absolutely sufficient, but the necessary auto-cooling is very, very hard to dial in without facing warping, even on PLA. The energy consumption of the 440-28 fans at full bore is tremendous, and worst of all, the noise level is killing me. Being next to the 24/7 Zero and 100% part cooling at over 90 decibel forces to ear protection and can be heard 2 floors above my printer room. Further downsides of my actual concept and designs, no enclosure possible and you need a capable external power supply. Let's fix this. I set a secret due date for the next video, so let's see how far I can get concerning the rework of the 24/7 Zero. We will see, because it's obvious, FDM still didn't reach its limits yet. Because DIY hasn't reached its limits yet. I'll also give my best to set my humble marks in order to close the gap between a 3.5-minute benchy-shaped object and ultra-fast printing at high quality. With that being said, thanks a lot for watching, servus und auf Wiedersehen. I'm not going to tell you that subscribing, liking, sharing and commenting will help and support 24/7 printing. Thank you. Further. And you typically use the max allowed line width. Das haben wir doch schon gehabt.